to Swanage service in Yate Parish. I'm not in Yate Parish, as you may have noticed. I'm in the Wye Valley, just outside Chepstow, scouting the walk for our walk to Tintern Abbey with the pilgrim group in a few weeks. And I'm about to walk through that big tunnel. And I think this big tunnel is a bit like how it feels for the last year we've had in lockdown. And now, hopefully over the next few weeks, we'll be coming out of lockdown into a different and hopefully better world. So here we are in the tunnel, and I think as we walk through it, we have those little guiding lights that light us along the way. It's a bit creepy in here, but I think it's a good way to think about how things have been throughout the pandemic, really. So hopefully over this last year, me and the church have guided each other, just like these lights are guiding me through the tunnel towards the end of lockdown. And as we exit lockdown, we need to think about how we can be better and how we can be better as church and as people and what we can learn from it. So this is where we are now at the moment, coming out of lockdown with just a couple of weeks to go. And that echoes where we are in the church's year. We're moving in a time of ascension of thy kingdom come, where we're praying for the coming of the Holy Spirit, where the Holy Spirit comes into our lives and renews us. And as we move out of lockdown, let's pray that we become better people, that the Holy Spirit dwells in us over the next few weeks, and we have the courage to exit the dark hole of lockdown and enter into a new way of being, into a new world. So I hope you're enjoying the service today. Don't forget to put your prayer requests in the comments. Don't forget to stand up and sit down and sing along with all the hymns. And watch out over the next few weeks as we exit lockdown. What is coming up in church? We've got this pilgrimage to doing this walk that I'm doing over to Tintern Abbey coming up, and lots of other things to check out as well. So let's leave lockdown in the power of the Holy Spirit when Pentecost comes and the church is reborn.
So a very good morning and welcome to all of you to this service of morning worship. As you probably gathered, I think that video was recorded a couple of weeks ago in the expectation that we might be coming out of lockdown tomorrow. It's taken on a longer life, so we'll be seeing it over the next few weeks before we have to replace it with another video. But again, a very warm welcome to all of you who are joining us online. It's very good to have you with us. And we hope you'll feel as much a part of this service as those of us who are here in church will feel. I want to also say a particular welcome to any of you who are back in church for the first time after lockdown. I know it all feels a bit strange and a bit weird being spaced out like this, but it's lovely to have you with us. And the first thing I need to do is publish some bands of marriage, and I have a feeling we have a couple of people with us to listen to their bands of marriage. So, I publish the bands of marriage between Graham Bairstow and Hannah Christie Whitfield, both of this parish but getting married at St Peter's Church, Frimley, Surrey, and between George Alfred Bale and Hannah May Waring, both of this parish, and getting married at St Michael and All Angels in Eastington, and between Ryan Mark Schofield and Rian Mayer Squire, both of this parish, and getting married at St Mary's Church, Timsbury, by qualifying measures. So all three of these are for the third time of asking. If any of you knows any reason why they shouldn't be getting married, then would you please have a word with me after the service? And am I right? Do we have Graham and Hannah with us? Lovely to have you with us this morning. We're going to pray in just a moment, but we hope that your wedding day will be a truly special one and will be the start of a fabulous marriage. I know St. Peter's Church, Frimley, I did my curacy over in Guildford Diocese, so a lovely church. So I pray, hope it will be a really special day for you, and it's lovely to have you with us. So let's just pause and pray for these couples as they begin this adventure of marriage. Heavenly Father, we thank you that you are the source of all being and the source of all love, and that you choose to share that love with us. We thank you that you brought Graham and Hannah, and George and Hannah, and Ryan and Rian together in your love. And we pray for them as they begin this adventure of marriage. We pray that their wedding day will be a truly special day, but also will be the start of a wonderfully fulfilling and lifelong marriage that will be a blessing not only to them, but also to their friends and family and to the community around them. We ask this in Jesus' name. Amen. So now we have our usual gathering sentences, and the key to this is anything you see in sort of orange type is what you join in with. And these sentences actually take on a particular significance today, because we're talking a bit about Father's Day, and in a moment we shall be hearing the song "You're a Good, Good Father," speaking about God's goodness. But before we hear that song, let's just say these gathering sentences together. God is good all the time. All the time, God is good. And let's hear now a little bit about the goodness of God in this song. Oh, hold on, before we pray. Can I suggest you stand and enter into a sort of spirit of worship as we listen to the words? I'm afraid we're not allowed to sing along. A bit of humming behind your mask might be okay, but yes. So, but I think we can enter into the song more if we stand. So if you're able to, please stand. If you prefer to sit, you can remain seated. Thank you.
Dead of night.
Will you please sit down? What a great way to start our service set with that reminder of the goodness of God and the assurance that we are loved so much that we're called deeper still into that relationship of love. We have a couple of other reminders at the start of this service, our usual reminders, which I think actually hark back to that video we saw of Howl in that dark tunnel, heading towards the light. And this is a reminder that the source of all light is God. So again, there are responses on the screen as I light the candles. God said, "Let there be light." Jesus said, "I am the light of the world." And he also said that if we follow him, we too can bring light in the darkness of our world. And that's our hope and prayer as we go from here today. So let us begin with our opening prayer. This is a prayer that does have actions. If you're slightly frustrated by not being able to sing out with all your heart, then you can express yourself in actions, but you don't have to. So the actions, when it comes up, are listed, I think, in brackets at the end of each sentence. But it's purely voluntary. So let us pray. Loving God, we have come here today to worship you. Help us to pray to you in faith, to sing your praises with gratitude, and to listen to your word with eagerness. Through Christ our Lord. Amen. So as I've reminded you, well, you probably knew already before you came into the church, today is Father's Day, but actually our service is going to weave two threads together as part of its theme. A little later, we're going to be continuing our exploration of the pastoral principles, which speak to the question of how we live together as the family of God, even though we don't always agree with one another. But we can't ignore the fact that it's Father's Day, and set aside as a time to reflect on the blessing of fatherhood at its best. I'm very aware that some people's experience of their fathers is not as it should be. And that inevitably has a bearing on their relationship with God the Father. But as our first song said, God is a good, good Father who only intends the very best for us and stands with us to help us to be our best. So to help us reflect a little on the blessing of a good father, we have a short video that puts a modern twist on fatherhood.
If you're still struggling with life in the real world, you're going to love our latest home speaker device.
Hey, Dad, what kind of pliers should I use on this?
You should be using a wrench.
Oh, do I have a wrench?
You have three.
Ah, thanks, Dad.
Introducing the Dad Personal Assistant, our newest smart speaker with all the character and compassion of a father.
Up and at him, it's a beautiful day.
Dad, it's Saturday.
Yeah, it's a great day to get outside.
It's 6 a.m.
Well, then you better get moving before it gets any later.
Designed with advanced features, the Dad PA connects to all your other smart home devices.
Dad, please set the thermostat to 70 degrees.
No problem. Setting the thermostat to 68 degrees.
No, let's keep it at 70 degrees.
Sure thing.
Thanks, Dad.
We're going to save so much money.
He syncs with your calendar to help you stay on track.
Looks like you're overdue for an oil change.
Oh, hey, you're right. Can you schedule one for Friday?
I've already got it scheduled. Just don't miss it, okay?
Okay, I won't.
Seriously, don't miss it.
Dad PA is always watching out for you.
Lights on. Hey, it's getting late. I think it's about time for Brad to head home.
Dad!
The Dad Personal Assistant includes a wealth of knowledge and opinions on a wide variety of subjects.
Dad, can you help me with my taxes?
Dad, do you know a good mechanic?
Hey, Dad,
Can you tell me a joke?
Sure. The joke is $1 billion.
I don't get it.
That's right. And you never will.
Nice one.
Oh, I'm hilarious.
Based on God's original design, the dad personal assistant is wise, caring, faithful, and devoted.
Don't worry. You've got this. You are the strongest person I know. You have made me so proud. You are God's child, and you don't need anyone else to complete you, especially not Brad.
Really, Dad?
I'm just saying, there's other fish in the sea.
Okay, wow.
The dad personal assistant. Always thoughtful, always dependable, and always there for you.
I hope you enjoyed that. Good, so that's maybe how things ought to be. We realise, of course, that things don't always work out as we would like, and that we need to come before God and before each other just to acknowledge our failings and to say we're sorry. So that's what we do now in our time of confession. We often build walls between ourselves and God. None of us is perfect, and those walls are built on the things we get wrong and on our weaknesses. In a moment of quiet, let us remember all those things for which we need to say sorry. Father, we have sometimes forgotten how wonderful you are. We are sorry. We have often tried to live in our own strength rather than trusting in you. We are sorry. We have even spoken words that are untrue or unkind to the people that you have given us to love. We are sorry. We are ashamed of some of our thoughts and have done things to make you unhappy. We are sorry. May the Father of all mercies cleanse you from your sin and restore you in his image to the praise and glory of his name, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. I'm now going to invite Lynn to come up and read our first reading for us from the book of Esther.
Reading is taken from Esther chapter 4, verses 6 to 17. So Hathach went out to Mordecai in the open square of the city in front of the king's gate. Mordecai told him everything that had happened to him, including the exact amount of money Haman had promised to pay into the royal treasury for the destruction of the Jews. He also gave him a copy of the text of the edict for annihilation, which had been published in Susa, to show to Esther and explain it to her. And he told him to instruct her to go into the king's presence, to beg for mercy and plead with him for her people. Hathach went back and reported to Esther what Mordecai had said. Then she instructed him to say to Mordecai, "All the king's officials and the people of the royal provinces know that for any man or woman who approaches the king in the inner court without being summoned, the king has but one law, that they be put to death unless the king extends the gold scepter to them and spares their lives. But 30 days have passed since I was called to go to the king." When Esther's words were reported to Mordecai, he sent back this answer: "Do not think that because you are in the king's house, you alone of all the Jews will escape. For if you remain silent at this time, relief and deliverance for the Jews will arise from another place. But you and your father's family will perish. And who knows but that you have come to your royal position for such a time as this? Then Esther sent this reply to Mordecai. Go gather together all the Jews who are in Susa and fast for me. Do not eat or drink for 3 days, night or day. I and my attendants will fast as you do. When this is done, I will go to the king, even though it is against the law. And if I perish, I perish. So Mordecai went away and carried out all of Esther's instructions. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
Thank you very much, Lynn. I'm very aware that's a bit of a sort of an EastEnders ending, isn't it? You know, what happens next? Well, you can go home if you would like and read the rest of the story, but Esther does actually go and speak to the king, and he receives her and hears of all that is about to happen, and thereby Esther is able to save not only her people, but I also think the whole kingdom from chaos and corruption that was taking over there. So our second reading today comes from Mark's Gospel. That day, when evening came, Jesus said to his disciples, "Let us go over to the other side." Leaving the crowd behind, they took him along, just as he was, in the boat. There were also other boats with him. A furious squall came up, and the waves broke over the boat, so that it was nearly swamped. Jesus was in the stern, sleeping on a cushion. The disciples woke him and said to him, "Jesus, don't you care if we drown?" He got up, rebuked the wind, and said to the waves, "Quiet, be still." Then the wind died down, and it was completely calm. He said to his disciples, "Why are you so afraid? Do you still have no faith?" They were terrified and asked each other, "Who is this? Even the wind and the waves obey him." Let's pray together. Lord Jesus, thank you for your word. Thank you for some of these stories and the things that we can learn from them. Thank you particularly for Esther's courage. And we ask now that you will help us to listen to what it is you have to say to us this morning. Amen. So one of the things that I observed during the 25 years that I travelled across the nations of Africa is that trying to silence opposition never really works for the long term. It might have short-term results, but it never works in the long term. Africa has seen its fair share of oppressive leaders, and they have all sought to try and silence anyone who didn't agree with them. They prefer to try and create the pretense that the critics weren't there and or didn't exist at all, and that everything in their nation was lovely. I think that was often born out of a sense of insecurity, but what happened is it created an unhealthy and dangerous environment, because it meant that there were never any checks made when there were errors of judgment. And I think it's possible to chart the decline of many regimes that were well-meaning at first and started well, but which unraveled into a morass of corruption and cruelty. And actually, we can see the same thing happening in Iran this very week over the elections and the sidelining of, I think it was over 600 people, opposition people who put their names forward for election. And lo and behold, the only one who's really emerged is an ultra-conservative imam from the regime. So that's what happens on one side. But on the other hand, there are leaders who allow debate, who listen to criticism, and who, I think, often avoid those pitfalls and mature into wise and benevolent leaders of an open and thriving society. I think the same thing can happen in families, actually, particularly with fathers who see themselves very much as the authority figure. They can become controlling, coercive, and even violent if their authority, or if they feel that their authority is being threatened. That is fatherhood at its very worst. But on the flip side, I personally was blessed with a wonderful father who was always interested in my views and what I had to say. He encouraged family discussion He encouraged family discussion to ensure that we were all secure and happy and that we all felt that our voices were being heard. Today's Bible reading from the book of Esther shows that when evil is on the march, there comes a time when it is imperative to speak up, where the silencing of criticism just won't do. There's a famous quotation that is attributed to William Burke, although there is some controversy about that. But the quotation says that all that it takes for evil to flourish is that good men do nothing. And we could add, or say nothing. In the aftermath of World War II, the Lutheran and Catholic churches in Germany bitterly regretted staying silent in the face of Hitler's oppressive policies. There were some brave people who did speak out, for example, Martin Niemöller and Dietrich Bonhoeffer. And some paid with their lives, as Esther feared that she might. But I believe that their courage helped to bring the evil that was happening in Germany to public attention and may have contributed in some part to the eventual downfall of the Nazi regime. In our reading, we see a change happening in Esther. She started from the position that it was just easier to keep quiet. I'm sure we all know that position. I often think when I come across difficulties, oh, it'd just be easier to keep quiet, wouldn't it? The difference is that in Esther's case, she rightly feared for her life. But eventually she saw that silence was not the answer, that something had to be said, and her speaking out saved her people. The pastoral principle we're looking at today requires us to speak into silence. And the supporting document says this: central to our understanding of the Christian community is that we are the body of Christ. We are called to relate deeply and openly with one another, sharing what is on our hearts as well as in our minds. We live and work together, offering and using our God-given gifts, blessings, insights and experiences. I think within the church there is a real danger that we spiritualize silence as something holy. Certainly there can be moments when silence can be very special and we can feel a closeness to God in that moment. But silence is definitely not holy when it's used as a tool of oppression. So as I explained 2 weeks ago in the introduction to these pastoral principles, they have come out of and are in a sense informing the discussion within the church at the moment about what our position should be going forward, recognising the concerns of the LGBTI plus community. And it's wrong to ignore the presence and concerns of LGBTI people, as if those people of that orientation don't somehow exist in the church. They do. Silence, when it's misused, can shelter abuses of power. People must be given space, permission and opportunity to speak. And if we do so, we will be fulfilling the principle of speaking into silence. Now, I have to confess that we have not talked enough about these issues in the past, and I regard myself as partly responsible for that. But that's something we want to address as we go through the autumn. The ministry team will be leading us through this process of exploring some of the issues so that we can hear and listen to one another. We may not be able to reach agreement. In fact, I think that's quite likely. But silence is not the answer. We must avoid the collective conspiracy of silence simply because that's the easiest option. Maintaining a pretense that the problem doesn't exist and that therefore that people do not exist is not a solution to the problem and is oppressive. It forces the problem underground into darkness, but it will always erupt again. So, we're called to speak into silence. And in that context, I have to say that I consider it equally wrong on both sides of the debate, equally wrong for the transgender lobby to try to silence those like J.K. Rowling who hold a different viewpoint, as it is for those who hold that different viewpoint to attempt to silence or marginalise transgender people. We need to talk about these things. We need to be able to discuss these issues openly, to listen to one another with an attitude of mutual respect, as King Xerxes did to Esther when she courageously ventured into his presence. We need to find a way to disagree well at those points where we cannot find agreement. That, I believe, is what any good father would want for his family. And that, I believe, is what God wants of us. Let's pray. Lord Jesus, we recognize that in your church we have often found it easier to ignore and stay silent about issues of concern to people, and that has not been the most helpful response. Lord, help us to speak into silence and to listen to one another so that concerns can be properly aired and we can seek a way forward together. We ask this in Jesus' name. Amen. So as we reflect on that reading and my thoughts that have followed on it, we're going to listen to a song now that is based on two parts of scripture, really. Firstly on Psalm 82, and then also on Isaiah 1:17, where God encourages us to speak out on behalf of the poor and the oppressed, to defend those who are marginalised. It's a song called "I Will Speak Out for Those Who Have No Voices." If you would like to stand, please do feel free to stand.
I'm
remain standing for the next thing, which is our creed, our affirmation of faith. And you'll see the words up on the screen. We're going to say this together. We believe in a bright and amazing God who has been to the depths of despair on our behalf, who has risen in splendor and majesty, who decorates the universe with sparkling water, clear white light, twinkling stars, and sharp colors, over and over and over again. We believe that Jesus is the light of the world, that God believes in us and trusts us, even though we make the same mistakes over and over and over again. We commit ourselves to Jesus, to one another as brothers and sisters, and to the Maker's business in the world. God said, "Let there be light." Amen. Will you please sit down? I'm sure it won't surprise you to know that our prayers today have a Father's Day theme to them. And will you please join in with the responses at the end of each section when I say, "Lord, in your mercy," please will you respond with the words, "Hear our prayer." Good and loving God, we are glad to give thanks for the love and dedication of the vast majority of fathers in the joyful task of bringing up children. Thank you for the time they give to work in the house and play in the garden, and to offering their children a model of committed care. Where fathers feel insecure or inadequate, reassure them that undiluted love is sufficient. Give them patience when things go wrong or get broken, and a reminder that lives are shaped over years, not fixed in minutes. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Good and loving God, we pray for those fathers who, like many mothers also, struggle to balance home and work responsibilities. Give both parents patient understanding and grace, both with each other and with their children. We pray too for those fathers who are separated by divorce from their children's day-to-day lives and miss them deeply. May their hearts be both tender in love and guarded from pain as they seek to redeem a less than perfect situation. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Good and loving God, we are glad to know you as Father, while acknowledging the gains of knowing you also through the image of Mother, for you are beyond gender. Show us how to parent our children richly and imaginatively, to offer them a creative mix of freedom within a secure framework, to stimulate their minds, cherish their ideas, enjoy their mischief, encourage their curiosity, guard their vulnerability, and to love them, love them, love them. And in a moment's quietness, we pray for our own children and for the youth work within this parish, for Praise and Play and Little Sparks, for Rooted and Rooted Plus as they meet this evening to say farewell to Gail. We pray too for St Mary's School, for all its teaching staff and all the children in that school. Lord, in your mercy, Hear our prayer. Good and loving Father, we pray for fathers across the world struggling to be good fathers, where they can't give their children sufficient food and shelter, security and education. Save them from despair. Give the international community a continued determination to eradicate poverty, control disease, and bring down infant mortality. And make us agents in the answering of our own prayers. And Lord, we pray particularly for the children of Yemen and all children across the Middle East, particularly those still living in refugee camps from Syria. Lord, we pray for children in all conflict zones. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Good and loving God, who gave Joseph to be a good and loving father to your son, Jesus, make ours a world of good and loving fathers, for Jesus' sake and the sake of our children. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. And Father, we also want to lift to you any within our own community who are struggling with the challenges of life at this time. Lord, we pray particularly for those who have lost loved ones. We pray for June and Linda Chilvers as they mourn the loss of Rita. We pray for the Bennett family as they mourn the loss of Stanley. And we pray too for Dave Bruton and Sue and the wider family as they mourn the tragic loss of David's sister. Lord, we also pray for all who are anxious or in despair or facing a terminal illness. Lord, be a good father to them. Comfort them in this time of difficulty. And encourage them with the knowledge that they are much, much loved by you. Merciful Father, accept these prayers for the sake of your Son, our Saviour, Jesus Christ. Amen. And our collect, which is the special prayer for this week. God our Saviour, look on this wounded world in pity and power. Hold us fast to your promise of peace, won for us by your Son, our Saviour Jesus Christ. Amen. And we gather all these prayers together now by saying together the family prayer, the prayer that Jesus taught us. And again, if you would like to express yourself in using actions as well, you are welcome to do so. We pray together. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. Now, just before we finish our service, there are a few notices which I need to run through quickly. As you are aware, probably, next Sunday is Gail's last Sunday with us. She's going to be here at St Mary's. She will be preaching and presiding for us, after the service we're going to have a farewell picnic, which hopefully the weather will be good enough for us to be on the Heritage Centre lawn. However, because unfortunately the lockdown or stage three has been extended for another 4 weeks, we are limited to a gathering of 30 people. So it is necessary, if you want to come to that picnic to say farewell to Gail, you do need to book by contacting Pam in the parish office. If you phone her up and find, all 30 places have gone, don't despair, because we're laying on a second farewell event later in the afternoon. So there's going to be a tea at 4:30 at St Nick's Church, which can take another 30 people. So again, you'll need to book for that tea, but you have a choice. Picnic lunch, afternoon tea. But do please give Pam a call and come along so that we can give Gail a good sending off to her new parish. And there is still time if you'd like to contribute to Gail's farewell gift. You just either pay some money into the parish account, I think details are on the internet, and you use the reference Gail, or you can drop money into the parish office and Pam will make sure it's added to the total. Please also remember Wanda in your prayers as she prepares for her ordination on Sunday the 4th of July in the afternoon. I'm afraid spaces down at the cathedral are limited, but I think it is going to be live streamed. So if you want to watch Wanda's ordination at 3 o'clock in the afternoon from Bristol Cathedral, you can do so, and details of that will be published a little bit later on. Yes, do please continue to pray for Wanda. It's only 2 weeks away. It's amazing how quickly it's come round. As you'll be aware, unfortunately, the COVID restrictions are continuing until the 19th of July. So we will have to remain socially distanced and in masks and not singing until that time. We are seeking clarification as to whether we will be able to sing for the first time on that first Sunday after the 19th of July. Very much hoping we will be able to. Praise and Play and Little Sparks are, however, operating, and so Praise and Play will be here tomorrow at 2 o'clock, Little Sparks at St Nick's at 9:30 on Tuesday. And I have a final notice, which I'm slightly uncertain as to whether it's accurate, and I wasn't able to check it, but the craft group were planning to reopen this Wednesday. Whether that's still going ahead in a socially distanced manner or not, I don't know. But if you would like to come along to the craft group, can you you could lodge an inquiry with Pam in the office tomorrow morning, and we will find out and get back to you. So I think that's probably the best way forward. So I think that covers all the notices. Yes. Sorry, yes, thank you. Yes, so there's a Mother's Union service on Thursday. Half past one. It'll be happening here in church. But you need to book. Okay, with Jackie. Yes, so 1:30, Thursday, Mother's Union service. If you'd like to come, please book with Jackie. It's going to be here in church. Good, thank you, Jackie, for reminding me. Okay, well, we're almost at the end of our service, so I would like to bless you now, and you'll see that there are responses on screen in gold. So may the light of Jesus shine in us. Amen. May the light of Jesus shine through us to others. Amen. May we be brave for Jesus. Amen. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be upon you and remain with you and those whom you love this day and always. Amen. Go in the peace of Christ. Thanks be to God. And we're going to just play our service out by listening to our final song, My Jesus, My Saviour. And please feel free to leave at any point that you feel you would like to leave. To free. So thank you very much, everybody, for joining us online. It's very good to have you with us. Don't forget the Zoom coffee afterwards. You can click on the link in the chat section. I hope you have a very good week. And thank you as well, everybody in church, for joining us. I hope you too have a very good week.